Hi, I'm Rich Slaton, and this is Inside the Play. Today, we're looking at three interactions from this match between SK Gaming and Tribe. Joining first, about 2 minutes in, this game between Tommy and Sam from King of the Hill. I wanted to show you this Goblin Barrel moment because it's important for how the overall situation goes. Tommy defends with Lumberjack. Why? Because he knows the Princess Tower is going to throw those arrows at the fisherman and not the goblins, so he can't zap it away. He has to defend like this, and he takes quite a bit of damage. But what's more important is that this overall idea defines how he has to deal with this variation on the Little Chen no spell bait Royal Giant deck. And you see Sam dropping Royal Giant. Tommy goes to defend with his Sparky, and Sam immediately drops that fisherman to predict the fisherman trying to pull the Royal Giant to the opposite tower. He gets that done perfectly. When that happens, Princess Tower targets Royal Giant. Goblins come in and Lumberjack down on defense. But look at that. What was a healthy tower in two sequences down almost all the way. Sam defends the Sparky with the Skarmy and gets opportunistic, gets smart, drops the Royal Giant using that Skarmy to defend the Royal Giant from any fisherman pulls. Tommy smartly zaps it off. Now here's the fun part. Normally, that fisherman would go where the X is, as we saw last time. But he knows that doesn't always work, so instead, he goes fisherman to the opposite side, pulls the Royal Giant back across the river, and fireballs the goblins, saving his tower and saving the game. This showed that Tommy was playing some of his best Clash Royale of the season against the best team in CRL West. But if you're talking about the best in the West, you have to also talk about none other than Javi Catorze. And this match came down to a 1v1 set between Javi and Tommy. And this was a really interesting game because Javi struggled on both sides of the board, offensively and defensively. He's running Goblin Giant Sparky Tommy, as you can see, running Royal Hogs. And take a look at Javi here, that little head tilt. He does that when he's annoyed, when he doesn't like an interaction. You can see he already knows that dealing with those Royal Hogs is going to be frustrating. He's going to have to always overspend to deal with those on defense. He's going to take damage every single time. So this is Javi's first really significant offensive play. He gets the Goblin Giant down in front of the Sparky, uses the Fisherman to pull the Mega Knight back, but the Goblin Cage at the end cleans up everything. The Sparky is not going to get a shot on tower and comes out completely with zero damage. And on the back end, when he goes to defend, he's not even going to get a healthy Hunter out of it. So take a look at Javi one more time. Big, big head tilt reset. Does not like that. And we're going to go through a few of these defenses just to show you an important fact about this game, how Javi continuously tries to defend the Royal Hogs using the Dark Prince. And he gets a lot of damage on the Hogs, but he also takes a lot of damage every single time, taking a few hundred HP off of his towers. And it happens over and over and over again. Now, this is Javi's next big offensive play. He's hoping that Sparky goes to the E-Wiz. He's going to Lightning the Magic Archer, the Goblin Brawler, and the Tower, but instead the Sparky turns towards the Brawler, so when he drops that Lightning, he actually gets negative value, doesn't take the E-Wiz off the board, so the E-Wiz helps clean up the Sparky, and now he's stuck playing defense on the right-hand side with a Mega Knight Leap, the left-hand side with the Royal Hogs going to Tower, and he eats a ton of damage one more time. Javi just cannot seem to get this figured out. Now, I showed you that Dark Prince stuff earlier, and this is important. Look what he's doing. Both of his towers within range of the kind of damage Royal Hogs can slice through, but he throws Dark Prince down at the bridge. What's he doing? And then you see Magic Archer on defense, and Javi has the Lightning. But instead of trying to get the Magic Archer off the board, he goes crazy with a prediction Lightning to take out the Goblin Cage, Goblin Brawler, and get the Dark Prince on tower. This is insanely aggressive and brave, but it's also knowing what Tommy had in store. But now, how does Javi defend? Snowball and Hunter. At this stage, he's not worried about a negative elixir trade. He's worried about keeping damage off the tower. He gets the Lightning in. Tommy can't believe it. He knows that game was his, and Javi just stole it right out from under him. And last but not least is this beautiful defensive sequence by Javi Catorze, where he not only defends very efficiently, getting zero damage, but he also gets a King Tower activation in the process. Remember that head shake from Javi before? Here we get a nod and to understand why he's so happy. Let's go back and break this down step by step because it is beautiful. Remember, at this moment, both of these towers are pretty much even in HP, and we're going to see how valuable this overall sequence of defense actually is. You see, Tommy has the Magic Archer, Mega Knight in front. Javi does something pretty basic here and drops the Ice Golem to pull the opposite side. But the smart part is he waits for the Mega Knight to leap before he drops the Musketeer on the outside to take care of the Magic Archer, preserving her health. At the same time, he drops a Miner in the pocket to pick up that Bandit Mega Knight aggro. Now he wants that Bandit to go to King Tower, but knows she might go to Princess. So what does he do? He throws a Snowball, retargets her to King, and does a little extra damage and slow to that Mega Knight that results in him dying in midair, saving 444 HP of damage to that left-hand tower. Now, remember that Musketeer? She is still alive and fairly healthy. She takes 3 shots on that tower before she falls, resulting in 543 damage dealt. This one sequence is a massive swing. Let's go to the end of the game where you can see, look at those towers. We're gonna do a little bit of math here to kind of look at what would have happened without that sequence. And you can see Tommy's tower would have been at 1599 and Javi's at 1342. So that might have saved the game all on its own. Now, of course, we don't know what every single play would have been, but how much HP you have does affect how you play. I hope you enjoyed these breakdowns. I'm bringing more of those to you pretty soon. Do me a favor, go ahead, like this video, comment, tell me what you want to see, and hit subscribe there on the bottom right-hand side so you can get more videos like this next time on Inside the Play.